friends, a warm welcome to all of you. I hope you are keeping well. I am also keeping very well. I am aware that May 2021 students, you all must be anxious. You must have covered your portion once, and now is the time to revise. We at JK Shah Classes want to be part of that revision. We want to help you for covering all important circulars, notifications, amendments, questions, which we believe are utmost important for your examination in May 2021. Friends, whatever you have studied, we want to concise it and revise it together. So friends, let's not waste any time. Let's start with our revision series. Let's start. Now friends, the first concept that we wish to cover is the concept of diversion of income versus application of income. Friends, this is covered in basic concepts chapter in your module. Now sometimes institute does ask a question on this, rarely, but it's a very nice concept. Basically, I can say that when income accrues to an assessee and after the income has accrued to an assessee, he decides to spend it in the manner that he wants. He decides to apply this income. Then that is called as application of income. What is it called? Application of income. As against that, in case there is a diversion of income by overriding title, yani मेरा इनकम अक्रू होने के पहले ही वो किसी ओवरराइडिंग टाइटल की वजह से डाइवर्ट हो गया है, वो कहीं और चला गया है, तो उसे हम कहेंगे डाइवर्शन ऑफ इनकम. व्हेन देयर इज एप्लीकेशन ऑफ इनकम, नेचुरली इनकम हैज अक्रूड टू मी, सो इट इज टैक्सेबल इन माय हैंड्स. बट इन केस ऑफ डाइवर्शन ऑफ इनकम बाय ओवरराइडिंग टाइटल, बिकॉज द इनकम हैज नॉट अक्रूड टू मी, before that income has accrued, already it has gone somewhere else. So it is not taxable in my hands. You know, I always give cricketing metaphors to explain this concept. It is like a batsman hitting a shot in the air, a fielder coming under the ball and trying to catch it. He catches the ball and in jubilation, he throws the ball in the air. Now another fielder comes under the ball and catches it. Whose catch was it? The first fielder or the second fielder? Naturally, it is the first fielder because he had already caught it. That is, my dear friends, application of income. Mere paas income aa chuka hai, ball aa chuki hai, uske baad main kahin aur apply kar dun, to wo catch to meri hai, income to meri hai. But as against that, sometimes it happens that the fielder is coming under the ball, but before he catches, some other fielder comes and snatches the ball away. He catches it. In that case, whose catch is it? It is the catch of the second fielder. So that is diversion of income by overriding title. So friends, based on that, we have taken two questions. Question number 1 part A and question number 1 part B. Let's read question number 1 part A. It says, Mr. Bhargav, a leading advocate on corporate law, decided to reduce his practice and to accept briefs only for paying his taxes and making charities with the fees received on such briefs. In a particular case, he agreed to appear to defend one company in the Supreme Court on the condition that he would be provided with 5 lakh rupees for a public charitable trust that he would create. He defended the company and was paid the sum by the company. He created a trust of that sum by executing a trust deed. Decide whether the amount received by Mr. Bhargav is assessable in his hands as income from profession. It's a simple guess. Of course, it is his income. Because friends, the person has fought the case. Mr. Bhargav has fought the case. The income has accrued to him. Now, after the income has accrued to him, he decides to give it to a public charitable trust or he decides to spend anywhere. That is his call. But as such, the company is giving the amount to the trust Because Mr. Bhargav is asking that. So it is the application of income by Mr. Bhargav. So here I would say the income is definitely taxable in the hands of Mr. Bhargav. So let's read the answer to this. It says, in the instant case, the trust was created by Mr. Bhargav himself out of his professional income. The client did not create the trust. The client did not impose any obligation on in the nature of a trust binding on Mr. Bhargav. So this amount being paid to the trust is a condition created by Bhargav, not by the client. Thus, there is no diversion of money to the trust before it became professional income in the hands of Mr. Bhargav. This case is one of application of professional income and not diversion of income by overriding title. Therefore, the amount received by Mr. Bhargav is chargeable to tax under the heads profits and gains from business or profession. I hope this first question is clear to you all. In fact, let me tell you friends that a very interesting altered version of this question was asked in your elective paper as a MCQ, as a multiple choice question. So I am writing it down over here. You can please copy it. That question was, let me keep the name same assessee, that is Mr. Bhargav. Mr. Bhargav fought a case for a client and asked the client to deposit the fees in an unregistered charitable trust. Such amount would be taxable in the hands of, in whose hands would it be taxable? Option A, Mr. Bhargav. Option B, no one. Option C, Mr. Bhargav and the trust. Option D, none of the above. Now please understand friends, here the answer would be C, that is Mr. Bhargav and the trust. Why in the hands of Bhargav? I just explained it. Because in case of Bhargav, the income is accrued to him, and after the income is accrued to him, he has diverted that income to the trust. But then sir, why would it be taxable in the hands of the trust? Because friends, in charitable trust chapter, now I can link two or more chapters. See, in the revision series, that's what's more important, that we have to link two or more chapters, because in examination conditions, that is what they can do. In your first reading, you have studied each chapter at once. Now in the revision, you should have that kind of alacrity of mind to link two or more chapters. So trust chapter mein aapne sikha hai that trust ko exemption sirf tabhi milti hai jab wo register hoti hai commissioner ke saath. Ye registration section 12AA mein hota hai. As such, last year government ne ek naya section nikala tha 12AB. But us section ko government ne defer kar diya hai suo moto kyunki coronavirus situation tha us wajah se. So as such, the trust has to be registered, only then it gets exemption of section 11 and 12. Yahan par question mein unhone kaha hai that ye trust unregistered hai. So when it is unregistered, it will not be entitled to exemption of section 11 and 12, and therefore this amount would be taxable in the hands of trust as well. So this would be taxable in the hands of Bhargav and it would be taxable in the hands of trust as well. This was one question asked in your elective international tax paper. As such, in elective also lot of things are common, that is why it was asked over there, but very well it can be asked in paper 7 as well. I hope friends this question was clear to you all. That was question number 1 part A. Let's proceed on to the next one. Question number 1, part B. It says, XYZ Limited took over the running business of a sole proprietor by a sale deed. As per the sale deed, XYZ Limited undertook to pay overriding charges. What it undertook to pay? Overriding charges of 15,000 per annum to the wife of the sole proprietor in addition to the sale consideration. The sale deed also specifically mentioned that the amount was charged on net profits of XYZ Limited, who had accepted that obligation as a condition of purchase of the going concern. Now that's very important. Is the payment of overriding charges by XYZ Limited to the wife of sole proprietor in the nature of diversion of income or its application? Discuss. Now please understand, friends, this is based on an Allahabad High Court ruling, that was Jeet Pal and X-Rays Private Limited. Now in this case, Allahabad High Court had held that where I purchased the business, see, a business is what? My source of income. So I purchased a business, but along with that purchase of business, I got a condition, I got saddled with a condition. Mujh pe ek condition thopa gaya. Wo kya condition thi? Ki main jisse khareed raha hun business, unki missus ko main pay karunga certain charges. So in that case, wo amount jo main pay kar raha hun, that is an obligation created on me, due to which I acquired a business. So this would be a diversion of income by overriding title, and therefore this 15,000 will not be chargeable to tax in my hands. Let's read that answer, friends. It says the issue came up for consideration before the Allahabad High Court in Jeet and Pal X-Rays Private Limited versus CIT Allahabad High Court. The Allahabad High Court observed that overriding charge which had been created in favor of the wife of sole proprietor was an integral part of the sale deed by which the going concern was transferred to the assessee. The obligation therefore was attached to the very source of income. Business acquire karna mera source of income hai, aur us source of income ke saath ek obligation attach kar di hai, that is the going concern transferred to the assessee by the sale deed. The sale deed also specifically mentioned that the amount on question was a charge on net profits of the assessee company, and the assessee company had accepted that obligation as a condition of purchase. Hence, it is clearly a case of diversion of income by an overriding charge and not a mere application of income. So friends, that was the concept of diversion of income versus application of income. Very important from examination angle, because sure shot you can expect a question on this. If not a big question, then at least a MCQ can be asked on this concept. Let's move ahead. Okay friends, now let's proceed on to the next question. This is the first blockbuster amendment for your exam, and that is tax rates applicable to an individual. As you are aware, in the current year, starting from AY 21-22, government has introduced an alternate scheme of taxation even for individuals by way of section 115BAC. So friends, government has said either the assessee can continue under the existing rates of tax or opt for the new regime as provided in section 115BAC. Ye existing rate of tax kya hai? Same as last year, koi isme tabdili nahi hui hai. So as far as any person other than covered in point number 2 or 3 below, that is an individual other than covered in point 2 or 3 below, or any HUF, unke liye rate of tax kya hoga? 2.5 lakh rupaye tak koi bhi tax nahi lagega. 2.5 lakh ke upar agar aapki income rahe par 5 lakh se zyada na rahe to 5% tax lagega. 5 lakh ke upar but up till 10 lakhs to us pe 20% tax lagega, aur 10 lakh ke upar tax rate 30% hoga. Ye progressive rate of tax hai, as you are aware, that agar meri income 12 lakh rupaye rahe to main seedha 30% nahi lagaunga, main pehle 2.5 lakh pe koi tax nahi lagaunga, baad mein 2.5 lakh se 5 lakh pe 5% lagaunga, 5 लाख से 10 लाख पे 20% एंड उसके ऊपर जितना भी इनकम है उस पे 30% टैक्स लगेगा। अगर आप सीनियर सिटीजन है, आपको ये चीज पता है, सीनियर सिटीजन भारत में कौन हो सकता है? ओनली अ पर्सन हुज अ रेसिडेंट इन इंडिया। वेर एवर इन इनकम टैक्स एक्ट वी यूज द वर्ड सीनियर सिटीजन, प्लीज रिमेंबर हम सिर्फ रेसिडेंट के बारे में बात कर रहे हैं। तो ये बंदा रेसिडेंट है एंड उसकी उम्र 60 से ज्यादा है, ही हैज अटेंड एज ऑफ 60 एट एनी टाइम ड्यूरिंग द ईयर बट नॉट अटेंड द एज ऑफ 80, क्योंकि अगर आप 80 ईयर्स या ज्यादा हो गए तो इन दैट केस यू बिकम अ सुपर सीनियर और वेरी सीनियर सिटीजन। तो अगर आपकी उम्र 60 या ज्यादा है तो फिर टैक्स रेट एज सच सेम है, सिर्फ फर्क यह है कि आपको 3 लाख रुपए तक टैक्स नहीं लगेगा। सो द बेसिक एग्जेम्पशन लिमिट इंस्टेड ऑफ 2,50,000 इट विल बी 3 लाख रुपीज। एंड इन केस यू आर अ वेरी सीनियर सिटीजन, दैट इज यू हैव अटेन्ड द एज ऑफ 80 और मोर एट एनी टाइम ड्यूरिंग द ईयर, देन इन दैट केस 5 लाख रुपए तक आपको टैक्स नहीं लगेगा। यानी पहला स्लैब ही निकाल दिया है, 2.5 लाख से 5 लाख का स्लैब ही नहीं है, सीधा 5 लाख के ऊपर जितनी भी आपकी इनकम है उस पे 20% टैक्स लगेगा एंड 10 लाख के ऊपर जितनी भी इनकम है उस पे 30% टैक्स लगेगा। डोंट फॉरगेट दिस पॉइंट इन एग्जामिनेशन, ओनली अ पर्सन हु इज अ रेसिडेंट इन इंडिया कैन बिकम अ सीनियर और सुपर सीनियर सिटीजन। इस पे मैं आपको एक चीज बताना चाहूंगा, एक चैप्टर है आपका डबल टैक्सेशन रिलीफ, ये इंटरनेशनल टैक्स में आता है, वहां पर एक एडजस्टमेंट पूछा गया था। ऑफ कोर्स द एंटायर क्वेश्चन वाज बेस्ड ऑन कैलकुलेशन ऑफ यूनिलैटरल रिलीफ अंडर सेक्शन 91, पर एक एडजस्टमेंट ऐसे दी गई थी दैट द असेसी, इफ आई एम नॉट मिस्टेकन द नेम वाज नंदिता, उस नंदिता की उम्र बताई गई थी एज 60 एंड शी वाज अ रेसिडेंट इन इंडिया एंड हर फादर वाज 84 इयर्स ओल्ड बट दैट फादर वाज अ नॉन रेसिडेंट एंड नंदिता ने पे किया था मेडिक्लेम इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ हर सेल्फ एंड हर फादर। सो उसका खुद का 32,000 उसने पे किया था एंड फादर का 60,000 क्या पे किया था? मेडिक्लेम पे किया था। नाउ फ्रेंड्स, आपको ये चीज पता होगी कि नॉर्मली इफ यू पे मेडिक्लेम इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ योर सेल्फ, स्पाउस इन दैट केस और चिल्ड्रन इन दैट केस, द डिडक्शन ऑफ मेडिक्लेम अंडर 80D इज 25,000 and in respect of your parents also if you pay the deduction is 25,000, but in case in these two buckets, yani either main, my spouse or children or parents, any of them is a senior citizen, then instead of 25,000 the limit becomes 50,000. but yahan pe situation dekhiye, Nandita hai resident and uski 60 umar ho chuki hai, so she is definitely a resident, so her bucket is 50,000. उसने कितना पे करा है? उसने 32,000 पे करा है, तो उसे पूरा 32,000 का डिडक्शन मिलेगा। बट फादर, although he is 84 years old, पर वो क्या है? वो तो है नॉन रेसिडेंट। नॉन रेसिडेंट्स आर नॉट सीनियर सिटीजन इन आर कंट्री, दैट्स द रीजन व्हाई फॉर हिम द मैक्सिमम डिडक्शन अंडर 80D वुड बी 25,000। सो नंदिता को ये पूरा 57,000 का डिडक्शन मिलेगा बिकॉज फादर विल नॉट बी कंसिडर्ड एज सीनियर सिटीजन। सो दीज कॉन्सेप्ट्स, यू नो, स्मॉल कॉन्सेप्ट्स, यू हैव टू बी अवेयर, यू हैव टू बी केयरफुल इन एग्जामिनेशन बिकॉज दे कैन बी आस्क्ड एट वेरियस पॉइंट्स इन टाइम्स और एज अ हिडन एडजस्टमेंट दे कैन कम एट वेरियस पॉइंट्स इन टाइम। एनीवे, सो अगर आप सुपर सीनियर सिटीजन हो तो आपको 5 लाख रुपए तक टैक्स नहीं लगेगी। गवर्नमेंट कहती है सुपर सीनियर सिटीजन को हम रियायत दे रहे हैं, 5 लाख रुपए तक कोई टैक्स नहीं लगेगा। बट ये याद रखिए फ्रेंड्स, इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ हाउ टू डिटरमाइन द एज ऑफ अ सीनियर और सुपर सीनियर सिटीजन, देयर इज वन वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग सर्कुलर ऑफ सीबीडीटी एंड दैट इज सर्कुलर नंबर 28 ऑफ 2016। व्हाट डज इट से? आई विल गिव यू एन एग्जांपल। लेट अस से फ्रेंड्स, आवर फाइनेंशियल ईयर इज व्हाट? वी आर अपियरिंग फॉर फाइनेंशियल ईयर 2020-21, दैट इज ए वाई 2021-22। Now if I were to tell you that the assessee was born on 1st April 1961, in that case उनका 60th birthday कब होगा? उनका 60th birthday होगा on 1st April 2021। अभी ध्यान से सुनिएगा। As far as financial year 2021-22 is concerned, as far as financial year 2021-22 is concerned, is this person a senior citizen? Absolutely yes. Because, sir, pehle din ko hi unka birthday ho gaya. So, as such, he has become what? Senior citizen on the first day itself. 60th birthday, pehle din ko hi ho gaya. But agar main aapko puchu, what about the status in financial year 2021? हम तो एग्जाम दे रहे हैं फाइनेंशियल ईयर 2021 की, तो उस ईयर में क्या स्थिति होगी? मे बी यू मे से दैट सर द बर्थडे वाज ऑन 1st अप्रैल, तो इन दैट केस फाइनेंशियल ईयर 2021 हाउ कैन यू बी कंसिडर्ड एज सीनियर सिटीजन? बट हियर फ्रेंड सीबीडीटी सेज दैट बेस्ड ऑन वन सुप्रीम कोर्ट रूलिंग, नॉर्मली स्पीकिंग मैं अगर आपको पूछूं, आप आपके बेस्ट फ्रेंड का जब बर्थडे रहता है, व्हेन डू यू विश, एट व्हाट टाइम डू यू विश? द मोमेंट इट इज 12 o'clock वी विश, इजंट इट? In fact, when it is our birthday, suppose our best friend does not call at 12 o'clock in the night, then we feel very bad. अरे यार इसने कैसे call नहीं कर दिया? So उस वजह से Supreme Court ने एक decision में कहा था कि as such the person turns senior citizen at 12 midnight itself. So you can say that he has completed the age of 60 on the midnight of previous day, that is 31st March 2021. And when is a person considered senior citizen? When he has attained the age of 60 at any time during the year. So, at 12 midnight, at least for that one moment, the person did become a senior citizen. That's the reason why, even in financial year 2021, friends, I will consider this person as a senior citizen. Ye CBDT ne accept kar liya hai position, aur unhone kaha hai ki agar aapki birth date 1st April को होगी, in that case, they have given the Supreme Court decision, that is Prabhudayal Sesma versus State of Rajasthan, and then they say that in view of the aforesaid judgment, the Central Board of Direct Taxes in exercise of powers under Section 119, now you all have studied one, Section 119 क्या है? Power of CBDT to provide instructions, orders to its subordinates. Hereby clarifies that a person born on 1st April would be considered to have attained a particular age on 31st of March, the day preceding the anniversary of his birthday. In particular, the question of attainment of age of eligibility for being considered a senior or very senior citizen would therefore be decided on the basis of above criteria. So friends, if in examination they ask us, if in an adjustment, this won't be asked as a separate question, बट अगर वो असेसी का आपको टैक्स लायबिलिटी कैलकुलेट करने बोल रहे हैं एंड कहीं पे उन्होंने मेंशन कर दिया है दैट ये असेसी 1st अप्रैल को पैदा हुआ है, देन यू हैव टू बी वेरी केयरफुल बिकॉज द डे प्रिसीडिंग इज बर्थडे वुड बी फॉलिंग इन अ डिफरेंट फाइनेंशियल ईयर एंड 1st अप्रैल इज फॉलिंग इन द फ्रेश फाइनेंशियल ईयर. सो आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस सर्कुलर इज रेलेवेंट ओनली फॉर दोज पीपल हु आर बॉर्न ऑन 1st अप्रैल. सो यू नीड टू बी वेरी केयरफुल इन एग्जामिनेशन कंडीशन. Fair enough, let's proceed. That was as far as the existing rates of tax are concerned, where the assessee individual is divided into senior citizen, super senior citizen and others. As against that, government ne is saal ek naya section insert kiya hai, that is section 115BAC. Ye section kya kehta hai? Government says that we don't want all these exemptions and deductions which are prevalent in Income Tax Act. If you see the way this government is going about, they are doing away with all these weighted deductions or special exemptions because they know there are a lot of leakages. Bahut hi galat fayda uthaya jata hai. Us karan se government ne kaha ki agar aap un exemptions and deductions ka sacrifice karne ke liye tayar hain, agar aap unko tyag denge, तो हम आपको कंसेशनल रेट्स ऑफ टैक्स देंगे एंड दैट कंसेशनल रेट ऑफ टैक्स इज गिवन इन सेक्शन 115BAC. दिस इज अ फ्रेश सेक्शन दिस ईयर, सो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम योर एग्जामिनेशन एंगल. आई एम फेयरली सर्टन समथिंग और द अदर बेस्ड ऑन सेक्शन 115BAC डेफिनेटली विल बी आस्क्ड, सो पे अटेंशन. What are the slab rates? First of all, in section 115BAC, there is no question of any super senior, senior citizen, others. For everyone, for every individual or HUF who opts for section 115BAC, 2.5 lakh rupay tak koi bhi tax nahi lagaya jayega. 2.5 lakh se zyada income hai, 5 lakh rupay tak 5% tax hai. Above 5 lakhs but up till 7,50,000, 10%. Above 7,50,000, up till 10 lakhs, it is 15%. above 10 lakhs up till 12.5 lakhs, it is 20%. Above 12.5 lakhs up till 15 lakhs, it is 25%, and above 15 lakhs, it is 30%. So you may say, sir, it's a no-brainer. Existing rate में तो 10% 10 lakhs के ऊपर ही 30% लग जाता है, यहाँ पे तो 15 लाख रुपए तक 30% tax नहीं आता, so this is better. But please understand, friends, the choice is not so easy because under section 115 BAC आपको बहुत सारे exemption deduction का sacrifice करना पड़ेगा. वो क्या क्या है, जैसे कि लीव ट्रैवल अलाउंस सैलरी चैप्टर में आप क्लेम नहीं कर सकते, हाउस रेंट अलाउंस यू cannot क्लेम, देन सेक्शन 10 क्लॉज 14 में जो अलाउंसेस कवर्ड हैं, बारिंग अ फ्यू विच आई हैव गिवन अहेड, दोज विल नॉट बी एलिजिबल. अलाउंसेस टू एमपीज एंड एमएलएस, उसका जो एग्जेम्पशन था वो नहीं मिलेगा. सेक्शन 16 में जो स्टैंडर्ड डिडक्शन है फ्रॉम सैलरी, दैट विल नॉट बी अलाउड टू यू. टैक्स ऑन एम्प्लॉयमेंट, दैट इज योर एंटरटेनमेंट अलाउंस टू गवर्नमेंट एम्प्लॉइज, दैट विल नॉट बी अलाउड. टैक्स ऑन एम्प्लॉयमेंट, दैट इज योर प्रोफेशन टैक्स, इज अगेन, यू नो हाउ मच इज दैट प्रोफेशन टैक्स, 2500 रुपीज फॉर द एंटायर ईयर. गवर्नमेंट सेज उसका भी आपको हम डिडक्शन नहीं देंगे. देन वेरियस एग्जेम्पशन डिडक्शंस फॉर अलाउंसेस ऑफ परक्विजिट, दे आर ऑल्सो डिसरिगार्डेड. इंटरेस्ट ऑन हाउसिंग लोन, प्रोवाइडेड द हाउस इज सेल्फ ऑक्यूपाइड और वेकेंट प्रॉपर्टी. अगर लेट आउट प्रॉपर्टी है तो आपको इंटरेस्ट का डिडक्शन मिलेगा, बट अगर ये सेल्फ ऑक्यूपाइड या वेकेंट प्रॉपर्टी है तो उसका डिडक्शन, इंटरेस्ट का डिडक्शन आपको नहीं दिया जाएगा. Family pension, again this we have learnt in IPCC, this also deduction will not be allowed to you. Deduction for clubbing of income of a minor child, 1500 rupees, that also government says we will not allow. The deductions under PGBP chapter like SEZ 10AA, additional depreciation 20% of cost of new plant and machinery, 32AD, as such 32AD is discontinued this year, so no question of availing it in any case. 33AB, that is your tea, coffee, rubber development account. 33ABA, site restoration fund. 3512, 3512A, this is all scientific research deductions. 352AA, that is national laboratory or university or IIT, you make a contribution, not allowed. 35AD, that is your specified business capex deduction that you get. Then moving ahead in section 80C, now deductions. LIC premium 80C का deduction भी आपको नहीं दिया जाएगा. 80CCC, that is your contribution to LIC pension fund, और 80CCD subsection 1, that is employees contribution to NPS, 80D, that is mediclaim. All, almost all kinds of deductions have been debarred. You cannot, you have to sacrifice it. 80G भी नहीं मिलेगा, 80GG भी नहीं मिलेगा, 80GGC भी नहीं मिलेगा, 80IA, these are the part C of chapter 6A, all those deductions also, total 41 exemptions slash deductions will not be allowed to you. After you ignore those exemption and deduction, only then you can avail the concessional rate of tax under section 115 BAC. So can I make a statement that now as an individual, what I would be required to do is first check under the existing scheme, if I avail all these deductions, then how much is my total income and tax liability? And then compare it with the total income and tax liability as per the section 115 BAC, ignoring all these deductions and exemption. And then I will choose naturally what? I want to minimize my tax liability. So I will choose whichever tax liability is lower. So in order to assist the assessee in practical life, what our government has done is they have launched an app, that is Aayakar Seva app, where you can put in your figures, punch in your figures and find out where is your tax liability, where, in which option it is lower, and make a informed decision. But please understand, friends, that once you make a decision, agar aapke case mein business income hai, kya hai? Business income hai, to ye option irreversible hai. So as far as people who do not have business income is concerned, for them this is option to be exercised each year, annually, har saal aap exercise kar lena. But in case of other persons, they have to exercise option once and then it is valid for all subsequent year till the time business is in existence. Option kahan exercise karna hai? Ye option exercise karna hai on or before due date of furnishing return of income. Also friends, as I told you that agar आपका बिजनेस इनकम है, देन इन दैट केस दिस ऑप्शन इज इररिवर्सिबल. वंस यू चूज दिस ऑप्शन, देन यू कैनॉट गो बैक टू द एग्जिस्टिंग रेट ऑफ टैक्स टिल द टाइम बिजनेस इज इन एग्जिस्टेंस. बट यहां पे फ्रेंड्स एक मैं सर्कुलर डिस्कस करना चाहूंगा, प्लीज पे अटेंशन. व्हाट इज दैट सर्कुलर? दैट इज रिगार्डिंग इंटीमेशन बाय एम्प्लॉय टू हिज एम्प्लॉयर, टू हिज और हर एम्प्लॉयर with regard to withholding tax under section 192. फ्रेंड्स आपने सेक्शन 192 को तो पढ़ा ही होगा. सेक्शन 192 में एम्प्लॉयर जो अपने एम्प्लॉई को सैलरी दे रहा है, एट द टाइम ऑफ क्रेडिट ही हैज टू विथहोल्ड टैक्स एट सोर्स एंड डिपॉजिट इट विद द गवर्नमेंट. दैट इज डिपेंडेंट ऑन द टैक्स लायबिलिटी ऑफ द एम्प्लॉई. वी हैव डन क्वेश्चंस वेर इन वी कैलकुलेटेड दैट व्हाट इज द टैक्स लायबिलिटी ऑफ द एम्प्लॉई एंड बेस्ड ऑन दैट एवरेज रेट ऑफ टैक्स एवरी मंथ यू हैव टू विथहोल्ड द टैक्स. सो नेचुरली एज फार एज एम्प्लॉयर इज कंसर्न दिस ईयर ही इज वरिड. ही सेज यार मेरा एम्प्लॉई 115 BAC लेगा कि एग्जिस्टिंग रेट लेगा मुझे तो पता नहीं. बिकॉज बेस्ड ऑन दैट चॉइस ऑफ द एम्प्लॉई द रेट ऑफ टैक्स विल डिफर. रेट ऑफ टैक्स डिफर्स तो देन टैक्स लायबिलिटी डिफर्स. टैक्स लायबिलिटी डिफर्स तो माई विथहोल्डिंग डिफर्स. सो दैट्स द रीजन वाई सीबीडीटी केम आउट विद अ इंस्ट्रक्शन सर्क्यूलर. दैट इज सर्क्यूलर नंबर C1 ऑफ 2020. ये सर्क्यूलर क्या कहता है? ये सर्क्यूलर कहता है that employee shall intimate to his employer that whether he wants to opt for the existing rates of tax or the new rates of tax, and based on that intimation the employer will continue to withhold tax. But please remember ye intimation jo employee de raha hai employer ko, this is not exercise of option as envisaged in section 115 BAC. सेक्शन 115 BAC में कहा है कि आपको एक्सरसाइज कभी करना है ऑप्शन एट द टाइम ऑफ फर्निशिंग रिटर्न. अभी जो आप इंटीमेशन दे रहे हो एज फार एज द एम्प्लॉयर इज कंसर्न दैट इज ओनली लिमिटेड टू विथहोल्डिंग ऑफ टैक्स एट सोर्स. सो ऐसा हो सकता है कि आप एम्प्लॉयर को बोल दो सर मैं 115 BAC चूज करने वाला हूं. एम्प्लॉयर अकॉर्डिंगली विथहोल्ड्स द टैक्स एट सोर्स एंड लेटर एट द टाइम ऑफ फाइलिंग रिटर्न यू डू नॉट चूज 115 BAC. दैट कैन वेरी वेल हैपन. But naturally, if the employer has withheld tax by giving a concessional tax rate and बाद में आप concessional tax rate choose नहीं कर रहे हो तो जो भी balance tax liability रहेगा if at all that you have to pay along with interest naturally. So please understand friends, the employee must intimate to his employer that whether he wants to opt for section 115 BAC or not. Accordingly, the employer will withhold tax under section 192. And after you have intimated the employer, that is not exercise of option under 139(1). At that time you can, at the time of furnishing return, you can choose whatever option you want, whether you want to go in for the existing rate of tax or the new rate of tax. But also please remember friends, that once you intimate the employer, बाद में employer उसी option के तहत उस साल में deduct करेगा tax. मान लो मैंने एम्प्लॉयर को अप्रैल में कह दिया कि सर मैं 115 BAC चूज करने वाला हूं. नाउ आई कैन नॉट टेल हिम इन मे दैट सर सुनो ना मुझे 115 BAC नहीं लेना है, आप एग्जिस्टिंग के हिसाब से काट लो. आपने एक बार एम्प्लॉयर को एक चीज कह दी, एम्प्लॉयर विल विथहोल्ड टैक्स एज पर दैट पर्टिकुलर रेट फॉर द एंटायर ईयर फॉर दैट पर्टिकुलर ईयर. इफ यू वॉन्ट नेक्स्ट ईयर यू चेंज द ऑप्शन, यू टेल दैट पर्सन सर मैंने 115 BAC नहीं लेना है या 115 BAC लेना है, वॉट एवर यू वॉन्ट. But within that year, employer for the purpose of withholding tax will follow that particular intimation that you have given. I hope this is clear. I am going to repeat this. Please pay attention because very, very, very important from examination angle. As far as any assessee is concerned, you can choose 115 BAC and switch the option every year. Ek saal 115 BAC le lo, dusra saal mat lo, third year le lo, chalega. But if you have business income, then that option is irreversible. Once you choose 115 BAC, it becomes irreversible for the future years till the time business is in existence. Point number 3, for the purpose of withholding tax at source under section 192, the employee must intimate to his employer ki which scheme he proposes to adopt, either existing rate or new rates. But that intimation to employer is not exercise of option as envisaged in section 115 BAC. Wo aap return filing ke time hi karoge. Ye to sirf intimation hai. But once you intimate the employer, then for that particular year, employer usi scheme ke tahat TDS kaatega. Then you cannot again switch within that year itself and change your intimation to the employer. You are not allowed to do that. So very important, friends, from examination angle. So please make a note of it. Fair enough. Let's proceed. I have taken an extract of this particular circular. I am quickly going through that, after which we will proceed on to the next concept. It says clarification in respect of option under section 115 BAC. Section 115 BAC of Income Tax Act inserted with effect from AY 21-22. Inter alia. Inter alia yani kya? Amongst other things, you know, this is legal language. Aap exam mein bhi adopt kar sakte ho. Like in examination, if you quote a decision and baad mein, let's say you just write down SA Builders. I am just giving an example. Aapne kahin likh diya SA Builders Supreme Court. And later after one or two lines, you again want to quote that decision. Then you can always say SA Builders Supra. Supra means what? As quoted above. So in practical life, when people quote in written submissions to the commissioner or to Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, the entire citation, CIT versus, like SA Builders, it was SA Builders versus CIT 2007, 288 ITR, page 1, Supreme Court. Now again, you need not write the entire citation. You can just say SA Builders Supra. So you can also do it in exam. The examiner will understand that yes, this person knows legal language. So similarly, inter alia means it says lot of things, 115 BAC. Amongst that, what it says is that it provides a person being an individual or HUF having income other than income from business or profession who may exercise option in respect of previous year to be taxed under section 115 BAC along with his return of income to be furnished under section 139 of the act for each year. The concessional rate provided under section 115 BAC is subject to the condition that total income shall be computed without specified exemption or deduction, set off of losses and additional depreciation. We just saw that 41 items. Representations have been made regarding what? Representations expressing concern regarding tax to be deducted at source have been received, stating that as the option is required to be exercised at the time of filing the return, the deductor being an employer would not know if the person being an employee would opt for taxation under section 115 BAC of the act or not. Hence, there is clarity regarding whether the provisions of section 115 BAC of the act are to be considered at the time of deducting tax. In order to avoid genuine hardship in such cases, the board, in exercise of powers conferred under section 119 of the act, hereby clarifies that an employee having income other than income under the head PGBP and intending to opt for concessional rate of tax under section 115 BAC of the act may intimate the deductor being his employer of such intention for each previous year. And upon such intimation, the deductor shall compute his total income and make TDS thereon in accordance with provision of section 115 BAC of the act. If such intimation is not made by the employer shall make TDS without considering the provisions of section 115 BAC of the act. It is also clarified that intimation so made to the deductor shall only be for the purposes of TDS during the year and cannot be modified during that year. Means the employer, once you intimate him 115 BAC karo, to pura saal wo wahi karega. However, the intimation would not amount to exercising option as envisaged in 115 BAC subsection 5, and the person shall be required to do so along with return of income to be furnished under 139(1) of the act for that previous year. Thus, option at the time of filing return under section 139(1) could be different from the intimation made by such employee to the employer for that previous year. This kind of statement, they may just put in examination and say true or false, state whether this statement is correct or not and explain. So very important from examination perspective. Now this was regarding people who do not have income under the head PGPP. Now what if I am an employee and I also have income under the head PGPP? Then they say further, in case of person who has income under the head PGPP also, the option for taxation under 115 BAC of the Act, once exercised for a previous year at the time of filing return of income under section 139(1), cannot be changed for subsequent years except in certain circumstances, that is when your business ceases to exist. Accordingly, the above clarification would apply to such person with a modification that intimation to the employer in his case for subsequent year must not deviate from the option under section 115 BAC of the Act once exercised in a previous year. In short friends, jo normal employee hain, jinka business nahi hai, wo to har saal option switch kar sakte hain. तो वो हर साल एम्प्लॉयर को बताएंगे 115 बीएसी के हिसाब से काटो या नॉर्मल रेट्स के हिसाब से काटो. बट एज फार एज दोज एम्प्लॉयज आर कंसर्न्ड हु आर आल्सो हैविंग बिजनेस इनकम, उनके केस में तो ऑप्शन इररिवर्सिबल है. तो अगर एक बार रिटर्न में उन्होंने 115 बीएसी ले लिया, ऑप्ट कर लिया, तो अगले साल एम्प्लॉयर को तो बोलना है भाई आप 115 बीएसी के हिसाब से ही काटो, बिकॉज यू हैव एंटर्ड 115 बीएसी, यू हैव बिजनेस इनकम, नाउ इट इज इररिवर्सिबल डिसीजन. So I hope you understand this circular, friends. I hope this concept is clear to you. Fair enough. Let's proceed, friends. After this, question number 3. Now this is based on the chapter of capital gain. The first two questions, if I were to give you a reference of module, first two questions were based on basic concepts chapter. This is based on capital gain chapter. In capital gain chapter, friends, do you remember section 45 subsection 1? Come on, let's quickly revise. I had told you that section 45 subsection 1 is the charging section, which says that any profits or gains arising from transfer of capital asset shall save as otherwise provided from section 54 to 54GB be chargeable to tax, and the capital gains so arising shall be deemed as income of the year in which transfer took place. तो दो बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट वर्ड्स थे वहां पे, एक था कैपिटल असेट और दूसरा था ट्रांसफर. दोनों की हमने एनालिसिस करी थी. आपको मैंने कहा था कि कैपिटल असेट की डेफिनेशन दी गई है सेक्शन 2 क्लॉज 14 में. एंड सेक्शन 2 क्लॉज 14 क्या कहता है? ये कहता है कि कैपिटल असेट इंक्लूड्स टू थिंग्स एंड एक्सक्लूड्स फोर थिंग्स. इट इंक्लूड्स व्हाट? इट इंक्लूड्स प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ एनी काइंड, वेदर और नॉट कनेक्टेड विद बिजनेस और प्रोफेशन. बट देन आई टोल्ड यू that capital asset excludes stock in trade. तो एक सवाल आता था कि shares and securities को हम क्या consider करेंगे? Will we see that it's property of any kind and therefore considered as capital asset? Or do we say that it is stock in trade and therefore the resultant income will go under PGBP head? The problem becomes even more acute because shares and securities के case में अगर capital gain आती है तो tax rate थोड़ा concessional है. शॉर्ट टर्म कैपिटल गेन अराइजिंग ऑन लिस्टेड सिक्योरिटी को रेट लगता है 15%. लॉन्ग टर्म कैपिटल गेन अराइजिंग ऑन ट्रांसफर ऑफ लिस्टेड सिक्योरिटी 2018 तक तो एग्जेम्प्ट था, उस पर कोई टैक्स नहीं लगती थी. पर 2018 के बाद 10% का टैक्स रेट है, ऑल्दो वहां पे भी आपको एक प्रोटेक्शन दी गई है ग्रैंडफादरिंग क्लॉज के तहत. वेलकम टू दैट ग्रैंडफादरिंग क्लॉज. सो द पॉइंट इज कैपिटल गेन्स पे टैक्स रेट कंसेशनल है इफ द ट्रांसफर्ड असेट इज शेयर्स एंड सिक्योरिटीज. As against that, if the transferred asset is stock in trade, then PGBP income is chargeable to tax at normal rates. Highest rate can be 30%. So naturally, there used to be a tussle between government and the assessee. Department used to say that main isko PGBP income manunga, high rate of tax lagaunga 30%. Assessee used to say that main ise capital gain manunga, concessional rate avail karunga. So government ne kaha, don't worry, we will provide certain clarifications as to how do we determine whether shares and security shall be treated as capital asset or as stock in trade. पहले तो उन्होंने क्या कर दिया, capital asset की definition ही change कर दी. वहां पे उन्होंने एक clause add कर दिया that in case of foreign institutional investor, in case of foreign institutional investor, always, always, always shares and security will be considered as capital asset. भले foreign institutional investor ने अपनी books में उसको स्टॉक इन ट्रेड दिखा रहे, कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं, उसको इनकम टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट कैपिटल असेट ही मानेगा. ये फॉरेन इंस्टीट्यूशनल इन्वेस्टर के लिए स्पेसिफिक अमेंडमेंट है सेक्शन 2 क्लॉज 14 में। पर जो बाकी लोग हैं आपके और हमारे जैसे लोग जो हैं उनके लिए गवर्नमेंट ने एक सर्कुलर दे दिया एंड दैट इज सर्कुलर नंबर 6 ऑफ 2016। एंड व्हाट डज दैट सर्कुलर से? इट सेज दैट अगर आपने जो बेचा है वो लिस्टेड शेयर या सिक्योरिटी है, वो क्या है? लिस्टेड शेयर या सिक्योरिटी है, तो फिर उसमें हम क्या टेस्ट लगाएंगे टू डिटरमाइन वेदर इट्स कैपिटल गेन और पीजीबीपी इनकम। फर्स्ट एंड फॉरमोस्ट, वेयर द असेसी ऑप्ट्स टू ट्रीट सच शेयर्स एंड सिक्योरिटी एज स्टॉक इन ट्रेड, वेयर द असेसी इटसेल्फ इररिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ पीरियड ऑफ होल्डिंग द लिस्टेड शेयर एंड सिक्योरिटी ऑप्ट्स टू ट्रीट देम एज स्टॉक इन ट्रेड, द इनकम अराइजिंग फ्रॉम ट्रांसफर ऑफ शेयर्स एंड सिक्योरिटी वुड बी ट्रीटेड एज बिजनेस इनकम। तो अगर असेसी ने खुद ने, मैं एफआईआई की बात नहीं कर रहा हूं, एफआईआई के केस में तो शेयर एंड सिक्योरिटी हमेशा कैपिटल असेट माना जाएगा, मैं बात कर रहा हूं ऑफ असेसीज अदर देन फॉरेन इंस्टीट्यूशनल इन्वेस्टर। फॉर दोज पीपल अगर उन्होंने अपने बुक्स में शेयर्स एंड सिक्योरिटी को स्टॉक इन ट्रेड ट्रीट किया है, देन इन दैट केस इट विल डेफिनेटली बी रिगार्डेड एज बिजनेस इनकम, इट्स कॉमन सेंस। सेकेंड इज दैट इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ शेयर्स एंड सिक्योरिटी held for a period of more than 12 months, sir, 12 months क्या है? 12 months के बाद वो long term बन जाता है। Preceding the date of transfer, if the assessee desires to treat the income arising from transfer thereof as capital gain, the same shall not be put to dispute by the assessing officer। यानी अगर आपने स्वयं उसको capital gain माना है, तो assessing officer उसमें कोई भी dispute छेड़कान नहीं करेगा, he will accept it। However, this stand once taken by the assessee in a particular assessment year shall remain applicable for subsequent years also. Yani assessee has to be consistent. He cannot change his stand as per whatever suits his convenience. He cannot do that. Other cases, in all other cases, first of all, sir, other cases kya hai? Can I say other cases is where it is listed security held for more than, for less than 12 months. And second, unlisted shares and security. So, unke liye kare, the nature of transaction, that is whether the same is in the nature of capital gain or business income, shall continue to be decided keeping in view the aforesaid circulars issued by CBDT. Yani baki shares and securities ke liye aap judicial precedents dekho, CBDT ke circulars dekho. Jaise ek judicial precedent hai Gopal Purohit, that was case of Bombay High Court, and second was case of Rohit Anand, that was Delhi High Court. Wahan pe unhone kaha tha ki aap dekho magnitude of transaction kya hai, you look at the frequency of the transaction. So if you are doing a trading, the frequency will be very high, volume will be very high, but if you are an investor, then the frequency of transaction may be very less. So those considerations will be seen to decide whether those shares and securities are capital asset or stock in trade. But if it is listed shares and security held for more than 12 months, definitely it will be treated as capital asset, it will not be disputed by the assessing officer. And in case the assessee himself treats it as stock in trade, then to usko hum PGBP income hi manenge. However, CBDT also goes on to say that agar aapne koi bogus ya sham transaction kiya hai, yani dabba shares mein trading kiya hai, aapne black money ka white money kiya hai, to ye actual mein share transaction hai hi nahi, ye aapki undisclosed income hai jo aap convert karke le rahe ho, so in that case benefit of circular will not apply to you because it's not a capital gain itself. So that's fine. That was as far as question number 3 is concerned with regard to your shares and securities, whether we will treat it as capital asset or stock in trade. I hope this question was clear to you.
Now friends, moving on to third proviso to section 48. Please note that up till 31st March 2018, this proviso has been inserted with effect from 1st April 2018. Let me give you a historical background with regard to this proviso and why it was inserted. Please note, up till 31st March 2018, if you are holding a listed share which was long term in nature, when does listed share become long term? When it is held for more than 12 months and you transferred it via recognized stock exchange, then the resultant gain was totally entirely exempt. No tax on that. Let the gain be 1 rupee, 1 crore rupee or 100 crore rupee, entire gain was exempt. But the government thought that why are we keeping it exempt? As it is, investor is earning money and not paying any tax to us. So they came out with an idea that we want to introduce a 10% tax on this. And it's a very simple tax in the sense, if you are now transferring a listed share which is held for more than 12 months, that is long term in nature, the full value of consideration minus cost of acquisition, the gain, will be taxed at 10%. Even though the shares are long term, still there will be no indexation benefit allowed. However, one thought came in government's mind, rightly so. Let us say that I acquired certain shares in 1972. Just an example. And I transferred these shares on 31st March 2018. My gain is 100 crores. Can I make a statement? Since I have transferred it on 31st, on or before 31st March 2018, my tax would be zero. No tax on this. Now let me say this share I just transfer on 1st April 2018. Just by change of one day, can I say this 100 crore will attract a 10% tax? So the gain would be taxed almost retrospectively. I hope you are understanding. Because this gain has not been earned on one day. It has not been earned between these two dates. It has been earned since 1972. So it would be a form of retrospective taxation, whereby my gains of over a number of years would be subjected to tax. That also is unfair. So the government thought, let us do one thing. We will keep a cutoff date. The cutoff date would be 31st Jan 2018. Sir, why 31st Jan 2018? If you remember my first lecture of rates of tax, that is introduction, I had told you that every budget is presented on which date? First day of February. So when the government announced on first day of February that we intend to introduce this tax, they said till yesterday, that is till 31st Jan 2018, whatever gains have arisen to the assessee, we don't want to tax those gains. That's why this 31st Jan 2018 has been kept as a cutoff date. Now, on this cutoff date, government says whatever is the FMV of the share. How do I get FMV, sir? As I told you that it's a listed share. So, the price on recognized stock exchange is very well available to you. So, whatever is the FMV of this share as on 31st March 2018 shall be substituted for the cost of acquisition. But it's not that simple. I'll tell you why. Let me take a very simple example. Let's say I had acquired certain shares for 100 rupees. On 31st, let's say I acquired in 1971. On 31st March 2018, my FMV is 1000. And in the year 2020, I transfer it for 1050. Can I make a statement that I will substitute this 1000 for the cost of 100? So in short, my gain will be 1050 minus 1000, that is 50 rupees. This 900 rupees will not be subjected to tax. Fair enough, no problem. The government's idea is exactly this. But if I directly take the FMV in substitution of the cost, then one more scenario, unintended scenario may arise. And that is, suppose in the same example, I acquired the share for 100. The FMV on 31st Jan 2018 is 1000. And in 2020, the value of share drops and it becomes 600. Now, can I say, friends, technically speaking, forget all these provisions. I acquired a share for 100. I sold it for 600. So, is there a profit or a loss? Of course, there is a profit. The profit is 500 rupees. But because government did not want retrospective taxation, they said you substitute this FMV for cost. So can I say if I substitute this FMV for cost, my net gain would be minus 400, 600 minus 1000. So in short, I am getting a notional loss. Although in reality, I am having a gain. This is also unfair because this loss can be set off against other income. That's the reason why government says we will give you a formula. Now please listen to this very carefully. The formula is higher of A or B. Sir, what is this A or B? A is your actual cost at which you had acquired. In my both examples, it is 100. B is lower of full value of consideration or FMV on 31st Jan 2018. Please understand this. My cost of acquisition for computing gain is higher of A or B. My A stands for actual cost. B stands for lower of full value of consideration or FMV as on 31st Jan 2018. Now let us see how this works. Can I make a statement that here if I write FVOC, FMV, lower of the above, that is B, actual cost, I'll call this B, and here I'll say higher of A or B. Let me take these two scenarios that I discussed with you all. Case 1, I had acquired the share for how much? 100. My FMV was how much? 1000. And I had sold in the first scenario for 1050. So we said taxing 50 rupees would be fair. Let us understand. So here what will happen? I will say lower of FVOC or FMV shall be 1000. Higher of B or A would be 1000. So can I say my cost will be 1000? I transferred it for how much? I transferred it for 1050. So how much would be my net gains? My net gain would be 50 rupees. Same conclusion that we derived. In the second example, can I say that although I should not be taxed retrospectively, but allowing a notional loss would be unfair? After 31st Jan, I don't have any appreciation. So there should not be any loss. But at the same time, all my appreciation was prior to this date, prior to 31st Jan 2018. So there should be no loss, no gain. Let's see how this works. So I will say FVOC was how much? It was 600. FMV was how much? 1000. So how much is lower of FVOC and FMV? Can I say 600? How much was my actual cost? It was 100. So higher of A or B is how much? 600. Now FVOC minus cost as per section 55 will be how much? 0. So neither am I taxing retrospective gains, nor am I allowing notional losses. So coming back to the theory, friends, in third proviso they say, provided that nothing contained in first and second proviso shall apply. So forget currency fluctuation. That's why I told you in first proviso that when it is listed share transferred via recognized stock exchange, situation is not covered under first proviso, but it is covered under third proviso. Shall apply to the capital gain arising from transfer of long-term capital asset, being an equity share in a company or unit of equity-oriented fund or unit of business trust referred in 112A. So all that they are saying is, forget about first and second proviso and how do I compute the gain? I compute the gain by taking directly full value of consideration minus cost of acquisition. But cost of acquisition, how computed? Under 55 subsection 2 clause AC. The net gain would be subjected to tax at what rate? At 10%. And how do I compute this cost? I told you higher of A or B. A stands for actual cost. B stands for either FMV or FVOC or FMV as on 31st Jan 2018, whichever is lower. Naturally, I will consider the FMV as on 31st Jan 2018, provided the share was acquired prior to 31st Jan 2018. If I acquire a share now, then there is no question of giving benefit of FMV. Let us see this under some examples. We have taken 5 examples over here, which captures all the scenario. My request to you all is that based on these examples, you can pause the video right now, compute it on your own, and then look at the answers as I am discussing it. So in the first case, FVOC is 3 lakhs. It is given in question. My lower of B1 or B2, I have named it as B1 or B2, that is your FVOC and FMV, can I say over here, would be 2 lakhs. And either that or actual cost, which is higher? Higher is 8 lakhs. So can I make a statement, friends, that here the loss is not notional. Here the loss is actual. I acquired something actually for 8 lakhs. I am transferring it for 3 lakhs. So my long-term capital loss would be 5 lakhs. In the second example, can I say lower of B1 or B2 would be again 2 lakhs? And 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs, which is higher? It is 3 lakhs. So my cost is 3 lakhs. FVOC, I have transferred it for 8 lakhs. So my net gains is 5 lakhs. Like that, I have covered other 3 scenarios as well. You can look at the answer. 2 points I want to tell you, friends. Point number 1, that when there is a loss, naturally, as per section 74, this loss can be carried forward. But please note, since it is a long-term capital loss, whenever loss arises on transfer of long-term capital asset, it can be set off only against the gain arising on transfer of long-term capital asset. Over here, this 5 lakhs will be carried forward for set off unless you have some other income in the current year. In second scenario, the gain is 5 lakhs. So what did I tell you? The tax rate is how much? 10%. But government here says, under section 112 capital A, that the gain would be subjected to tax at 10% on the value of gain above 1 lakh rupees. So up till 1 lakh, like a basic exemption limit, it is not taxable. But if I ask you, please don't make this mistake in exam. The gain amount is 5 lakhs. Don't say 1 lakh is exempt. If you say 1 lakh is exempt, you are absolutely wrong. Nothing is exempt. Entire 5 lakh will form part of my total income. But while computing the tax, I will say gains will be taxable at 10% on the value of gain over and above 1 lakh rupees. So can I say gain above 1 lakh rupees here would be 4 lakhs. Total gain is 5 lakhs. Over and above 1 lakh is 4 lakhs. On that 4 lakh, 10% would be 40,000 rupees. So that is as far as section 112A, read with third proviso is concerned, third proviso to section 48. The entire loss, I've given a note over here, the entire loss of case 1, 2 and 3 will be, 1, 3 and 5 will be carried forward to future years as per section 74, same thing what I discussed. One more point, please note over here, friends. The government observed prior to this regime of third proviso to section 48, read with 112A, government observed one thing. And that was that many people misuse this concessional rate of tax, which up till 2018 was 0%. So they misuse by actually showing that they had acquired certain shares, which in reality was never acquired. They try and book losses or gains by showing as if the transaction is conducted via recognized stock exchange. Over here, in order to stop such practices, government said that I will make one small amendment, which is carried forward to the current section as well. And that is, the benefit of third proviso will apply, provided the asset is long term, that we already know, provided shares are listed, that is also we know. But the security transaction tax, when you conduct any transaction of purchase or sale via recognized stock exchange, there is an attraction of securities transaction tax. Securities transaction tax should have been paid on such equity share at the time of acquisition and transfer. Acquisition and transfer, so both. At the time of acquisition also and at the time of transfer also, security transaction tax should have been paid. Only then this proviso will be attracted. So can I say as a corollary, if you do not pay security transaction tax at the time of acquisition or at the time of transfer, then this proviso is not attracted. So gain will be computed in the normal manner and taxed at 20% by availing indexation benefit. But government observed one problem in this. That was, security transaction tax was introduced in India on 1st October 2004. So as such, let's say, I am a promoter of a company. I started my company from scratch in the year 1960. I got it listed now and I want to transfer the shares. At that point in time, government says, oh, this is not a genuine transaction. Why? Because in 1960, there was no security transaction tax. Don't you think that's a bit absurd? That's why government said, don't worry. We will restrict this condition of payment of security transaction tax at the time of acquisition of equity shares only to 3 types of transaction. How many types of transaction? 3 types of transaction. And that is given in notification number 60 of 2018, which says that condition of payment of security transaction tax at the time of acquisition of shares shall apply only if share is acquired on or after 1st October 2004. That was the date when securities transaction tax was introduced in India. Further, even for acquisition after this date, the condition for payment of STT at the time of acquisition that is applicable only to three types of transaction. Only three types of transaction I need to see whether STT was paid at the time of acquisition. And what are those? That to the transaction should be after which date? 1st October 2004. If the transaction is prior to that date, then condition of payment of STT does not apply for acquisition of share because there was no STT in first place. And which are these three types of transaction? First is preferential issue of shares which are categorized as less frequently traded. So in stock exchange, there are two types of shares. One which is highly traded, which are blue chip companies and medium companies. There are other penny stocks which are less frequently traded. If you are dealing in those kind of shares, government says, I will allow you benefit of 112A provided at the time of acquisition of shares. Also, you had paid securities transaction tax. Second, acquisition of shares of company which is already listed in recognized stock exchange. So suppose you are acquiring the share in 2005 and at that point in time the share was already listed. Then government says, why did you not acquire it via recognized stock exchange? Why did you acquire in off market mode? So at that time government will say, I will deny you the benefit of 112A. So in such case also the share should be acquired via recognized stock exchange through payment of securities transaction tax. And the third is that acquisition of shares in a company at the time when share is delisted. So in case the share was delisted and you acquired the shares, government says benefit of 112A will be denied to you. With that, third proviso to section 48 is covered. Just to recap this proviso, friends, third proviso to section 48 is attracted only when the shares are listed. Share should be long term in nature, and at the time of acquisition of such shares and transfer, you should have paid securities transaction tax. The mode of computation is fairly simple. You take the full value of consideration, reduce your cost of acquisition, the resultant gain over and above 1 lakh rupees is taxed at the rate of 10%. But the tricky part in this section is with regard to computing the cost of acquisition, which has to be computed through a formula. We have already done an example on that. The formula is higher of A or B. A stands for the actual cost of acquisition, B stands for lower of full value of consideration and FMV as on 31st Jan 2018. I hope this concept is clear to you all. So if your total income has exceeded an amount of 50 lakhs but does not exceed 1 crore, then the rate of surcharge which is attracted on the tax is 10%. If your income exceeds a crore but does not exceed 2 crore, then it is 15%. If your income exceeds now 2 crores but does not exceed 5 crores, then it is 25% surcharge. And in case your total income exceeds 5 crores, then your surcharge rate is 37%. It's a very high rate of surcharge. Now, after this surcharge was introduced, foreign institutional investors as well as various assessees raised concern that why on an amount of capital gain we have to pay such high surcharge. So government reviewed its decision and they came out with a taxation ordinance in which one of the points covered was with regard to this surcharge. So let us look at that point, that now what will be the surcharge attracted on the amount of capital gain. So it says surcharge in case of income including long term capital gain under section 112A or 111A. Extract of Finance Number 2 Act 2019, read with Taxation Amendment Ordinance 2019. So it says, if income of individual or HUF or AOP or BOI, including income referred in 112A or 111A exceeds 50 lakhs, then the rate of surcharge is 10%. Now 10% surcharge, nobody has a problem. Even 15%, nobody has a problem. So the second point is, if total income of individual HUF, AOP, BOI, including the income referred in 111A and 112 exceeds a crore, then it is 15%. But now, if total income of an individual HUF, AOP, BOI, excluding income referred in 111A or 112A, exceeds 2 crore, then the rate of surcharge is 25%. So please note, friends, that whatever is your income under 111A, what was 111A? Tax on short-term capital gain arising on listed securities transferred via recognized stock exchange. And 112A was tax on long-term capital gain arising on listed securities transferred via recognized stock exchange. That's the grandfathering clause which we just covered. In both these cases, you exclude that income. And even after excluding that income, if your balance normal income exceeds 2 crore, then rate of surcharge will be 25%. So in short, on these two incomes, under 111A and 112A, the maximum rate of surcharge shall be restricted to 15%. So on the other normal income, it can be 25 or 37%. But on the income covered under 111A and 112A, the rate of surcharge will be maximum 15%. Coming back to point number 4, if total income of individual HUF, AOP or BOI excluding income referred in 111A and 112A exceeds 5 crore, then the rate of surcharge will be 37% on the balance normal income. When in the above scenario 4, total income including income covered under 111A and 112A exceeds 2 crore, then surcharge is at the rate of 15% on such long term and short term capital gain. So note, friends, that in case your income is exceeding 50 lakhs or 1 crore, don't worry. But if your total income exceeds 2 crore or 5 crore, then I have to apply first point number 3 and 4 and see whether after excluding the capital gain also, my balance normal income exceeds 2 crore or 5 crore, in which case on that balance income, the rate of surcharge will be 25 or 37%, but maximum surcharge on the long-term or short-term capital gain covered in 111A and 112A will be 15%. Let us have a look at certain examples on this to elucidate this point. Look at scenario number 1. My salary income, that is your normal income, is 1 crore 50 lakhs and short-term capital gain covered under 111A is 1 crore. So my total income, is it exceeding 2 crores? Yes. Now please note, friends, calculation of tax as such is not very difficult for you all, because short-term capital gain is attracting 15% rate of tax, whereas balance normal income, you will apply the slab rates that we just saw in the rates of tax chapter, which was chapter number 1. Please also note, friends, for the current example, I have not considered the effect of 115BAC. If the question says consider 115BAC, that is your alternate tax regime, in that case, the rate of tax only differs, otherwise the entire calculation remains the same. Now, once I know this tax amount, question arises, how much will be the surcharge? Now, please note, friends, these point number 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, I have to apply in the reverse. If point number 5 is satisfied, I will not move on to point number 4. If point number 5 is not satisfied, 4 is satisfied, then I will not move on to point number 3. And so on. So look at point number 5. It says, when in scenario 3 and 4 above. What was scenario 3 and 4? Scenario 3 is total income excluding income referred in 111A. Now exceeds 2 crore. Is my total income excluding, if I exclude this, is it exceeding 2 crores? Answer is no. If I exclude my total 111A income, is my total income exceeding 5 crore? Answer is no. So can I say scenario 5 does not apply because scenario 3 and 4 does not apply? So as such, now I go on to scenario number 2. I hope you are understanding this. Scenario 5 is not satisfied because scenario 3 and 4 are not satisfied. So I move on to scenario number 2. Scenario number 2 says, if total income of individual including income referred to exceeds 1 crore, then surcharge will be how much? 15%. Let's see if that is happening. Is my total income exceeding 1 crore? Yes. So I will say my rate of surcharge is 15% on total tax. That is 8,71,875. Total tax plus surcharge is so and so. I will add health and education cess of 4%. So my total tax comes to 69,51,750. Let us take another example. Example number 2. Now in example number 2, again can I make a statement? Scenario 3 was what? Without looking at it, you can try. Income excluding income referred in 111A and 112 exceeds 2 crore. And in scenario number 4, total income excluding income referred in 111A exceeds 5 crore. both that is not attracted even here. So can I say that scenario 5 will not be attracted? Now let us look at scenario number 2. Total income, including income referred in 111A, exceeds 1 crore. Is that happening? Yes, that is happening again. So can I say again, after you calculate the tax, which you all are experts at, I will calculate the surcharge at 15%. Total tax plus surcharge will be 28 lakhs odd. I will add 4% health and education cess. That will give me my final tax liability. Let us look at the last example, please. In the last example, my balance normal income, that is salary income, is 2 crore 50 lakhs. My short term capital gain is 1 crore. So can I say my total income is 3.5 crores? Now, what does scenario 3 say? Total income, excluding income referred in 111A, exceeds 2 crore. Is that happening? Yes, it is happening. So my total income, excluding income referred in 111A, is exceeding 2 crore rupees. So as per scenario number 3, I will say my rate of surcharge on that tax attributable to the normal income will be 25%. But what did I tell you earlier? That scenario number 5 tells me that in scenario number 4 or 3, if total income including income referred in 111A exceeds 2 crores, then rate of surcharge on such long-term and short-term capital gain is maximum restricted to how much? 15%. So I will say my tax has two components. One component is the tax on short-term capital gain, which attracts surcharge of 15%. And second is the tax attributable to normal income that will attract tax rate of 25%. So here, surcharge will have two columns. One is the surcharge on normal income, tax on normal income, and second is surcharge on the tax attributable to the short-term capital gain, which is restricted to how much? 15%. So my total tax plus surcharge comes to 1 crore 8 lakhs 63,625. I will add 4% cess to that to give my final answer, 1 crore 13 lakhs 6,250. I hope, friends, this is clear to you all. Now, under section 48, certain balance miscellaneous kind of provisos are left. The next concept that we have to see is with regard to rupee denominated bonds, also known as masala bonds, which is covered in fifth proviso to section 48. Now, friends, what are these masala bonds or rupee denominated bonds? For funding infrastructure projects, Government of India allows that Indian company can raise money from non-resident investors through bonds which are denominated in INR. The investor will make investment in foreign currency. However, the bonds will be denominated in Indian currency. That is called as rupee denominated bond. Or some non-resident investors, because India is associated with masalas, so they call it as masala bonds. Now, the point is that when rupee denominated bond is transferred, at that point in time, normally the redemption is at par. However, there may be a scenario wherein, although the transfer of such bond is at par, it may give rise to a capital gain. I'll explain you how through an example. Let us say that I have acquired certain bonds, subscription of, let's say, $1 lakh worth of bonds. The rate of US dollar is 70 rupees at the time of subscription. At the time of redemption, the rate of $1 US is 63 rupees. The redemption is at par. But see what happens. Since I had invested $1 lakh, so my investment cost is 70 lakhs. My redemption also is at 70 lakhs. At the time of investment, since the rate was 70 rupees to a dollar, my cost of acquisition in original foreign currency comes to 1 lakh. At the time of redemption, my rupee has gone to 63. So as such, rupee has become stronger to a dollar. So when I convert it into dollar, I get more dollars. That is 1,11,000 triple. So although my redemption in INR is at par, I get a capital gain of 11,111 when I convert it into the original foreign currency. Can I make a statement that this entire 11,111 is arising only due to the appreciation of rupee against the foreign currency? This should not be taxed. The reason is, as such, logically speaking, the redemption was at par. There is no appreciation in the value of capital asset. To avoid such taxation, government inserted fifth proviso to section 48, which says, I'm reading it verbatim, provided also that in case of an assessee being a non-resident, any gains arising on account of appreciation of rupee against a foreign currency at the time of redemption of rupee denominated bond of an Indian company held by him shall be ignored for the purpose of computation of full value of consideration. So in my example, can I make a statement? This entire 11,111 was arising on account of appreciation of rupee. So by applying my fifth proviso to section 48, I will say ignored as per proviso 11,111, the taxable capital gain shall be zero. There will be no capital gain taxable in my hands. So this is a beneficial provision which is given to a non-resident investor. However, I wish to clarify on three aspects as far as this computation of rupee denominated bond is concerned. Aspect number one is that they are asking us to ignore what? Any fluctuation or only appreciation? They are asking us to ignore only the appreciation of rupee. Let us assume a reverse scenario. Suppose there is depreciation of rupee. In that case, can I say instead of a notional gain, there will be a loss arising to the assessee? Does that loss have to be carried forward or should it be ignored? The answer is that loss is allowable. It can be carried forward because this proviso requires us to ignore only the appreciation part of the currency fluctuation, not the depreciation. Aspect number one, appreciation of rupee denominated bond due to currency fluctuation, ignore it. Depreciation due to currency fluctuation, consider it, the loss will be allowable. So it is, you know, it's like heads I win, tails you lose. So although the appreciation is ignored, government says depreciation is allowable, so that it's a benefit given to the non-resident investors. That is point number one. Point number two, they say this entire fifth proviso will apply when? Not when any transfer takes place. They say at the time of redemption of rupee denominated bond. What will happen if the transfer has taken place prior to the redemption? Now that scenario is addressed not in section 48, but it is given in section 47. Please note, friends, section 47 covers transactions which are not regarded as transfers. There are 18 transactions given in section 47. We have to cover those 18 transactions in depth, but currently only I am talking with regard to rupee denominated bond. So if you refer this chart, which you can see behind you, that if rupee denominated bond is transferred by way of redemption, then there is no problem at all. It is a transfer, but fifth proviso is attracted, which makes it tax neutral. The entire appreciation on account of entire gain on account of rupee appreciation has to be ignored. But suppose it is transferred before redemption, then what happens? Then there are three scenarios. Section 47 says that if you either transfer this rupee denominated bond to another non-resident outside India, or you transfer this in an international financial service center, IFSC, either you transfer before redemption, you transfer it outside India to a non-resident, or you transfer in India in international financial service center to any person, then the transaction is not regarded as transfer. When it is not regarded as transfer, charging section is not satisfied. There is no question of computing capital gain. But suppose in any other scenario, let's say you transfer within India to not within IFSC, but outside IFSC, then of course it is a transferred. Further, because it's a transfer before redemption, you will not get the benefit of fifth proviso to section 48. So friends, please note over here, rupee denominated bond, first and foremost, I have to see whether there is transfer by way of redemption or transfer before redemption. If it is transfer by way of redemption, fifth proviso applies. If it is transfer before redemption, fifth proviso does not apply. And in case that transfer before redemption is outside India to a non-resident or within India at International Financial Service Center, then transaction itself will not be regarded as transfer. In case it's a transfer outside IFSC within India, but outside IFSC, then it is a transfer. Further, you will not get benefit of fifth proviso to section 48 because it is not transfer by way of redemption. Now here one small query arises, which I have in mind. You can put your thought to it. Suppose person A subscribed to the rupee denominated bond. he transferred those rupee denominated bond before redemption to person B. Now what happens to person A, whether it's transferred or not, immaterial. My question to you is that whether person B will get benefit of fifth proviso to section 48 if he continues to hold a rupee denominated bond till the time of redemption. So in short, if I may rephrase my question, does the benefit of fifth proviso to section 48 apply only to the original subscriber Mr. A, or does it apply to any person who is holding the rupee denominated bond at the time of redemption? Here the government has made their intention clear through one small amendment. Only one word was changed, and in fact I have struck out the old word and inserted the new word so that you can better appreciate it. It says, provided also that in case of an assessee being a non-resident, any gains arising on account of appreciation of rupee against foreign currency at the time of redemption of rupee denominated bond of Indian company held by him. What was the word earlier which has been struck off? It is subscribe. So earlier the benefit of fifth proviso to section 48 applied only to the original subscriber, not to any other person. But now let's say original person subscriber is Mr. A. He transfers before redemption these bonds to Mr. B, and B holds it up till the time of redemption. Even for Mr. B, since he is holding the rupee denominated bond at the time of redemption, benefit of fifth proviso will continue to apply to him as well. I hope, friends, with this, fifth proviso to section 48 is clear to you all.